Hey guys, it's Coben McCool. Today I want to take you through an R&B trap beat with some smooth hip-hop and electronic overtones. If you're new here, thanks for checking out the video and thanks to everyone for liking and subscribing. I really appreciate it and it really helps. Now I'm going to play you a demo of the beat and then I'll get straight into the breakdown. Now the order that I put this together was a little bit different from usual because I wanted to go into this with the instruments having one of the key driving forces of the song, but I knew I wanted the rough rhythm to then put some instrumental ideas on top of. So initially I created the kick and the snare pattern just as it was. And then added the hats. So I had a little bit of a chug, a bit of a rhythm going, so that I could then add instruments on top of. I didn't add anything else to the drums from that point. I then jumped on to the instruments so that I could play around with different chord patterns, different sound design. I find this a really effective way to make quick progress and test out ideas without just getting bored or running out of inspiration. The first idea that I tested was this shimmer. It was a patch that I originally designed with an omnisphere. I added some saturation to it just to make it more interesting, and I also added a gross beat. And within the gross beat, I have a quarter bit gate that just makes it pulse, and then I also have a half speed, which as you can imagine would half the speed, but it also brings in lower frequencies so that it's a bit of a thicker sound, but I don't have it turned right up to the top because then it would all be too muffled. I still wanted that shimmer up at the top, but I just wanted the sound to be a little bit thicker. I ended up doing this with quite a few of the instrument sounds so that it kind of felt like they were all moving and shuddering together rather than just this sound alone having this weird characteristic and the rest of them sticking out and not being the same. So the strings and this bell synth that I added in after both have a similar gross beat effect on them. So then when I add my basic drum pattern back in, then I knew I wanted to add in some strings that would bounce along with the track and would kind of complement it. And the original pattern that I went for was actually far too complicated. I will try and show you it here if my computer will allow me to. It'll also be in a different key because I transposed it down 3 by the end of it. It sounds quite cool on its own, but then when you pair it with everything else or you try and add a vocal in, good luck because there's just no space. I was actually having quite a lot of fun with that style, but I thought, okay, I need to cut some of this back if I want there to still be space for other elements. So I just left the elements that I liked the most, and that was the dum dum, the kind of pulse or bounce that it had. There. So I just refined the string pattern to end up with this. And that left a lot more space, but it also worked much more harmoniously. It complemented the movement of the drums a lot more and wasn't quite so chaotic. Then when I pair that with the pulsing synth, you've already got a track that's moving and swaying quite nicely, because it's got that underlying shimmer, which is just giving this flow. It's got the drums providing the punch, and it's got the strings dancing along with the drums. But there is still a decent amount of space there that you could add a vocal on top of. I then decided to add in one other element. What I realized early on is that I wouldn't be able to have them all on all at the same time, because it would be too much. So the idea is that they would come on and they would come off, and that would create different sections or flow within the song. So I added in this bell synth. Then it would come off and it would flow with a bass element that I would eventually add in. Then come back in with the drums. Then the strings replace it, but the swell synth still continues. So you've got three different elements, of which either one or two are playing at the same time, and you swap them around interchangeably. One of the temptations as a producer is to get a sound that you like, and another sound that you like, and another sound that you like, and throw them all together. It just gives your beat a little bit more characteristic or dynamic when it's got somewhere to go and then return to, and it's just telling a little bit more of a story than just a wall of sound that then comes on and off again. Like in movies, certain characters have their own theme song. Well, you can also inject a certain emotional element just from one instrument sound, but it doesn't have to be on all the time. The beauty of it is it comes on and then it's taken away. And then when it comes back, there's this feeling of familiarity, and the brain just seems to really like that kind of thing. Once I had my instrumental elements in, I could then think about adding in some sort of bass structure that would really fill everything out and start pushing everything really powerfully. I tested a few different bass styles and sounds, and I think if I turned this into a final song, I'd probably add in one or two more in different sections. For now, I just went for an 808 that I added a reasonably large amount of distortion to, but I also controlled it with a high pass filter. So as you can see, I have Wave Shaper here just pushing up just to add even more distortion. And then I have an EQ here, which I automate to pull away some of that high end that also comes from this fruity fast distort. So many of the built-in FL Studio stock plugins are great for shaping sounds. I think the temptation is always there to look outwards for paid plugins. A lot of these very simple plugins are actually really powerful, so long as you don't overdo them. So I have this Fruity Fast Distort turned up so that it just creates a bit more crunch up at the top end. I've also pulled it down here within the effects channel because I didn't want it to overpower. Now when you listen to it on its own, it sounds like the saturation would maybe be too much. But when I add in my other instrument elements, you find that the high end in the instrument fuses really well with that high end in the distortion of the 808. But it means that your 808 still has some presence, because if you take the distortion off of the 808, it's almost too soft and smooth, and I wanted it to have a little bit of grit. So the key thing here is making sure that you listen to those sounds together to get an adequate amount of saturation, rather than just listening to the 808 on its own. So then, having all of that together, I could then spice up the drums a little bit more so that it had a little bit more energy and zest to it. The question I was always asking is, does it contribute to the flow and the movement that there is there already, and how can I get them to dance together? I think it's so useful to view your music moving as if it was going to be danced to. What does it make your body do if two people were dancing to it together? How would the music instruct them to move, or just make them feel? That's why I have open hats at the beginning of phrases to emphasize the entry, and then you have slightly higher, shorter static sounds in the middle whilst it's still up, and then falls back down again. It's so easy to overdo these, and I think that is why I waited until I had my other elements in and then added them, so that they would just complement what was already there. Then the final thing I did to spice everything up and give the beat a little bit more depth was just added in some filtering so that it would feel a bit more intimate and intense, and a vocal at this point could really shine. I did that by putting a filter on the drums and on the sub, and on the instruments, but all separately, because I didn't want to just do the stereotypical DJ swipe down of everything. I wanted to choose how much of each sound I wanted to get rid of and at what point. And it just means that it feels like it's breathing a little bit more. It's got a little bit more liberty and expression to the filtration. Now, it does take longer, but I would say that it is worth it. Okay, so you'll hear everything starts to fade down, all as a one, but you still hear the instruments calling a little bit. Then the high end of the bass starts to come up. Drums, oh no, wait, pause. Okay. Yeah. Woo! Yeah. So let me talk you through some of the automation here, because it's quite intricate, but it really makes a massive difference. Actually, initially you can see that I have a volume automation on the drums, and sometimes I turn the drums off completely, but I still have the samples there. And the reason for that is that I have sidechained the kick and the snare to the instruments and the instrument effects bus that I have here. So I take my kick and my snare and I sidechain them to the instrument bus and the instrument effect bus, and then create a separate sidechain with the kick and a separate sidechain with the snare for each of them. Then when I then play the instruments and the drums, but I turn the volume of the drums here down, that signal is still going through to the instruments. So the instruments are being sidechained, you're just not hearing the kick and the snare. So you're still getting that swell, it's just you're not getting the heavy thud from the drums. What that then does is it makes you feel like there's still this movement, but the heavy bass isn't there because the emphasis from the kick hasn't arrived yet. But it just makes it even more satisfying when the kick comes straight back in and drives everything together. Then I fade the volume of it up at the end, but I also have this low pass filter so that it fades up with it. So it's not just increasing in volume, it also feels like it's emerging out from underwater or something to that effect. If I take the drums away in this section, listen to what the instruments sound like without it. Now, it's not a massive difference, but it's still subtle, it surges. So I have a low pass EQ on the instrument bus, which I showed you here, which just has all of the instruments, the shimmer chords, the bell synth, and the strings, all sent to it here, and then the effects, which is the reverb and the delay, sent to a separate bus here. I then take a parametric EQ and I just automate this effect. Oh, I've just realized that I labeled this as high pass filter when actually it should be low pass filter. Sometimes my brain does that, I confuse those around because it's high pass or low cut, or low pass and high cut. So yes, this was a low pass filter just like the rest of those filters were a low pass filter. So if I remove the low pass filter and I play the 808, in this intimate section, it's just too buzzy and overpowering. So by adding it in, it just subtly takes control of it, but it releases it up before it releases everything else up. So you still get some of that energy coming through, and it's a really nice, raw, satisfying sound. Then in the final breakdown, I just turn things on and off just to add some emphasis overall, and with the 808, I make it slide down one final time so that it goes. And if I play that pattern with the drums, just to really emphasize the fact that the beat is about to smash back in with the vocal as well, it just sounds ace. All I did to do that was created a relatively aggressive slide note here. So it starts here and slides straight down to there in a very short period of time, but it's very emphasized. And then also having the open hat just makes everything crash and drop down all at once. And it's so cool. Then when I add the instruments with that, but of course I had to cut all of them away to allow the 808 to be emphasized and shine like that. With something that is this energetic or this built up, I knew that I was gonna have to layer the vocals in order for the vocal to really shine in those sections. But because I'd created also those more intricate sections, I could then also create some smaller, more delicate vocals to complement those smaller sections. So the main way that I do that is I have a main vocal that is dead center and has my main vocal chain on it, of which I've had to mute the de-essers that I've been using because my computer can't play them all at the same time, but we find a way. Then I have a layer that is pushed hard left and hard right of a slightly different vocal take. You can do this with the exact same take. You're more likely to have phase issues, so it's better to do it with a slightly different take. But one of these I've also pitched down an octave. Then I have one more that is panned also, but not quite so aggressively and pitched up an octave. And when I pair all of those together, running back, still running back in my mind, feeling that I still feel it through my spine. And then I just have a volume automation and an effects automation so that in those smaller, more intricate sections, I can push the presence of the main vocal down a little bit to give space for more ethereal sounds by then pushing the vocal effects up. No, I won't make it out alive. And yeah, that was everything that I did. I really hope that you guys enjoyed this beat. So that was a slightly longer breakdown today. I just wanted to go into more detail, firstly, because I love it. It's really good fun. And secondly, just because I really appreciate being able to give you guys value and hearing back from you when you say that you're learning a lot of things from these videos. It's been awesome to connect with you guys recently, and I really appreciate when any of you leave comments or messages on my Instagram. Thanks so much to everybody who's been checking out the channel recently. I really hope that you guys continue enjoying the content. You can probably click on one of my other videos just now, and I look forward to sharing the next video with you. But until then...